and welcome to Aloha Authentic. I'm your host, Kamaka Pili. On today's show, we're here at Ke'ehi Lagoon Memorial State Park to talk about lua, or Hawaiian martial arts. Fun fact, lua means the number two, but this art carries it as its name because it represents duality. With action comes reaction, and with life comes death. Did you know? Now you do. He's a master crafter with weaponry and implements, but also an olohe lua. I want to welcome to the show Uncle Umi Kai. Thank you very much, Uncle.
Malo.
Well, of course, we have our protocol before we get into our conversation. Our umeke, our bowl of poi, is open on the table because Tutu used to always say, when the bowl of poi is open on the dinner table, no negativity is spoken, only words of positivity, creation, and in this sense, also healing when we're talking about the topic of lua or Hawaiian martial arts. So again, thank you very much, Uncle. I'm really excited about this. You know, we mentioned that your title is Olohe Lua. Can you explain what that is?
The term Olohe Lua refers to the head or the master of the craft. Olohe actually means hairless, and so those that were practicing and achieved the status of the highest rank would pluck their hairs so that nothing could be grabbed during a battle.
Well, speaking of battle and speaking of Hawaiian martial arts, I mean, every culture I can assume has their own arts of war and mm-hmm. battle and warriorship. What makes Hawaiian martial arts so unique? What does lua consist of?
It's a hard question and easy. Lua is different and significant because it's Hawaiian. And we're not sure of the origin of how the lua practitioners got all of the eyes or the strikes. But it is an old art, and the mixture of the healing along with the maiming or the dislocations is a key factor. And although today's olohe luas and the practice of lua is far from the kahiko, vau kahiko practices, we still try to implement programs within our haumana that tells them, if not directly shows them, the concept of healing, what to say, because words hurt.
I mean, when we're talking about martial arts in the battlefield, was it like close range type of battle, more strikes, not necessarily far range kind of a...
Yeah, there's a misconception that the Hawaiian weapons are lua weapons, when in actuality, the lua practitioner prefers to use his hands, and that's his weapons. He does have to practice and be proficient in the use of all the other weapons so that he can defend himself. It's like the meaning of lua, it's the duality. In order to protect yourself, you need to know how to use it.
In the ancient days, how did battles even start? What was the reasons that kicked off wars and battles?
That's a funny question, only because it could be anything. Ali'i's wanting to expand their ahupua'a and take on others, ahupua'a and dominate over other islands or other mokuere on the island itself. It could be a grudge against another one. Could be just about anything. But it was a warrior culture, and we lost that when the Kamehameha unified the islands. He took that warriorship down because nobody had to fight anymore, and so it's a sad thing and yet a good thing. There's that duality again.
Well, speaking of duality, I mean, when you're on the battlefield, of course, you're in battle. But what about when warriors were off the battlefield? I heard that the hula was brought into play for warriors as a means of keeping their skills up while they're off the battlefield. Is that true?
I believe it was, and there's a close correlation between hula and lua. And remember, these are human beings, these are men. So when they're not on the battlefield, they need to tone themselves, they need to keep in shape, and they need to be doing the farming, and they need to be doing other fishing items in order to sustain and provide for the families.
Well, you mentioned, you know, while these are men on the battlefield, what about the wives and the wahine? Were there roles that women served in lua?
Yeah, women served a very vital role. They were a support, for the most part, providing backup to their warrior, picking up weapons, handing it to them.
Really? We're in 2022 now. I mean, all we're speaking about is in the ancient days, but lua still plays a role. How can you see lua being relevant to us today?
Lua today is a practice by men and women of how to be a better person, not only for your family and for your community, but better person for yourself. If you cannot feel better about yourself, it's very difficult for you to go and help others. So we try to implement programs and instill in our homeowner that it's very important to make sure that your family is taken care of. And before you can do that, you gotta take care of yourself.
Healing.
Healing. Awesome. Healing is very, very important. It's self-healing and outward healing.
Thank you very much, Uncle. Stick around, because coming after the break, we're going to elaborate more on that of healing. Auntie Lynette Paglinawan joins us to talk about that. Coming up right here on Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic, and welcome back to Ke'ehi Lagoon Memorial State Park, where they serve as an envisioned living memorial dedicated to honoring all veterans. A beautiful place over here. Speaking of beautiful, I want to introduce our next guest, Auntie Lynette Paglinawan, who is a pillar in Hawaiian knowledge, healing arts, also social work, and a practitioner in lua as well. So thank you very much for your time, Auntie. Speaking with Uncle Umi, he helped to paint the picture of the battle scene for us. But when we talk about lua, there is that duality. So with destruction comes healing. Tell us a little bit about how important healing is when it comes to lua.
Healing with regard to lua is a balance in life. It's about recognizing while one engages as a warrior and leaves the family, somebody has to maintain life on the homestead. Although lua had their own wahine koa, many of the warriors recruited to do battle on behalf of the ali'i left the children and families back on their homestead. The maka'ainana who went to help the ali'i had to feel secure in themselves that their absence will not create undue stress in the family. So kupuna, or the mama left home, had the kuleana to be the main pillar until papa returns. This required doing ho'oponopono with the family to restore balance and harmony that got disturbed by the additional chores to be done.
What is ho'oponopono?
Ho'oponopono is a family problem-solving process that helps to prevent little seeds of discontent from getting larger. And so the practice of ho'oponopono allows family members to talk about how or what they did to get somebody upset, to misunderstand, or even sometimes the sassy attitude. Lua, I feel, has to be looked at as a philosophy of life. If you're going to be the protector of your family, your protector of your land, your homestead, protector of your sovereignty, Lua has principles. One of the principles that was imparted to us was to live in a balanced way with Aloha, with Ma Lama, and being Pono. Aloha is that essence of genuineness in whatever you do. Ma Lama is remember to care for each other and help each other out. And Pono is recognizing sometimes as humans we get off base. That means we Pono ole, and you better get back on even kill again. We do that through Ho'oponopono.
So that's really to correct and to realign.
Yes.
And yes. That's really the essence of Lua, right? Is to bring balance.
Yes.
You know, you do a lot of influential work in social work. How do you see your traditional knowledge influencing the realm of social work?
The relevancy comes in the recognition that there are many Hawaiians being serviced by state institutions, social service agencies, which tells me there's been a breakdown in their Hawaiian way of living. And restoring Lua is one of the means by which we can give them positive handles in life today, so they can feel proud of themselves and their heritage. Bishop Museum is a must. They house all of our objects that were signs and evidence of intelligence, creativity, artistic inventions, and indications that our people were inventors and innovators. So, going back to Hale Pihopa gives physical evidence of this. So, although the practice of Lua is not going to be as effective against guns today, there are more intrinsic values in the philosophy that undergird a Hawaiian way and a Hawaiian style of living. Tourists pay money for the Aloha spirit. We don't just talk about it, we live it. And that is inbred in us through practices like hula, la'au, la'pa'au, lomi, ho'oponopono, lua.
Well, Auntie, I wish we had more that reflects the amount of mahalo I have for you, but here's just a little makana that we can share with you. Thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate that. Oh, this was so awesome. Stick around because Uncle Umi Kai will return, this time focusing on Hawaiian weaponry, even teaching us how to make one of our own. That's coming up right here in Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic, and welcome back to Ke'ehi Lagoon Memorial State Park. Originally built in 1964, the obelisk is a symbol that perpetuates the reverence held for those who died in defense of the country. It's a beautiful place down here if you haven't already checked it out. And speaking of beautiful, Uncle, thank you very much for sharing all of this. And
beautiful.
I know you're beautiful as well. Sorry if you were waiting for that. But, you know, with all of this, we were mentioning you're a master crafter in weaponry and implements. Do you mind sharing how to teach me how to make a weaponry?
I don't mind. Yeah. Weapons are can be anything, right? Anything can be a weapon. And what I'm going to teach you to make is considered more of a utility knife than a weapon. But anything can be a weapon, as I stated, so a simple stick or stone and words. Those are all weapons. The lua practitioner would use his hands and his words. Mm-hmm. So a niho oki is a single tooth cutting implement or utility knife, such as these here all in the front. We have different samples of the designs. Some are straight. This one is made out of a pig jaw. Wow. Then you have koa, and you have a great white tooth there. You have tiger tooth here, and these are bull shark. I use bull shark in substitute for great white.
What does niho oki mean?
Niho tooth, oki cut. So it's okay. A single tooth cutting implement.
Okay, awesome. So I see these are the beginning stages.
Correct.
Of making it. So what's the next step? I'm excited to
next
go,
step
go
is
with this.
Get a little dirty.
Okay.
Dusty, I should say. So when I teach in the classes, I use a rasp, a metal rasp, and what you want to do is round off all of these edges here and on the opposite side, just to give it a smooth texture or feel. This would be a finish. This is what your goal is, to get it into this nature here. Okay. You can use a rasp, and then they go from the rasp to a file. In Kahiko, Val Kahiko days, a rasp could take the form of a nuku, the bill of a marlin. And it works basically the same way as the current modern day rasp.
So there's all the like a sandpaper kind of a texture over it.
Yes, it's more, it's, I think they call it dentin, but it's more scales.
Awesome, yeah. Okay.
So you get to work.
Okay, awesome. So this is a niho oki, but what were some common weaponry or implements used during battle?
Yeah, weaponry could be a variety of different things. The longer ones, ihes and pololus, I didn't bring, but these are nevas. And nevas are war clubs, some with just wood. Solid wood, then you have those with a wooden handle and a pohaku or stone head that is lashed onto it. Then you have another type of neva that fits in your hand for clubbing either side into the temple or the skull. Yeah. Then you have a weapon like this one, which was made famous by Wahine.
Really?
And this is called a pikoi or ikoi. There's a mo'olelo about Kavelo being saved by his wife using a pikoi against Kauahoa, which is considered a giant on Kauai. She was able to assist her husband.
So, Uncle, let's say, what about on the battlefield? Was it where men were in the quote-unquote front line and women were in the back more?
Yeah.
In the shadows.
Yeah, I wouldn't tell the women that, but no, the women could be up front, women could be up, and the men in the back. It all depends on your skill and your enthusiasm, wanting to get in there. Women were as much a fighter as the men were. Now, they're primarily, the men would be going in first to clear the way. Women could be joining them as well.
Since we're talking about the battlefield and being in war, you know, we hear especially today rules of war and rules being broken in war. Were there rules in ancient days in Hawaii?
Yeah. Rules, I don't know if that's the proper terminology for it, but there are protocols. And protocols could be, as an example, the first killed. The first one that dies in a confrontation, all the fighting stops, and that body is then taken as a sacrifice, the lehua taken as a sacrifice. Then after the ceremony is done for the lehua, then the battle ensues again.
So everybody just stops then as a, like a respect out of?
The respect for the first killed.
Wow. You know, and I know we have, every year we have makahiki season. And there's a lot of games that is played during that time. And the story always goes, or that I've heard, was during makahiki season, all war ceased during that time.
Yeah, there's been new research come to light that the battles that took place or can take place during the makahiki season, but except for approximately four days. That is couple.
That's fascinating. You know what else is fascinating, Uncle? Mm-hmm. My work. So I didn't get as far as I was hoping to, but I know this would be what we're going for. What would be the next step after we sanded down the sides?
After you've sanded down or filed down and you would sand it to a degree that you like, then you would be oiling it. And the final step would be to lash the niho, or the tooth.
That you harvest yourself.
sometimes, yes, but mostly no.
Well, thank you very much, Uncle. This is just amazing. I wish we had more time to talk more about this. Maybe that's next Aloha Authentic. Stick around, we'll be here right after the break. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. If you didn't know already, Ke'ehi Lagoon Memorial is a great place for local businesses to host meetings and retreats. They're also very involved in our community with our veterans and youth in many different ways. To find out more about them, visit their website, klmemorial.org. Speaking of finding out more, Uncle, thank you very much. I mean, I wish we had a big enough makana to show my gratitude, but here's something small.
Mahalo to you.
If people want to find out more about what you do, is there a website they can visit?
Yes. I have a personal website, kaicompany.com, company with a K, not a C.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Uncle. Mahalo. For our featured artist in this episode, we're bringing our attention to a small business from Kalihi Oahu named Hiva Creations. They share nature and culture through handcrafted and laser-cut woodwork and koa accessories, interestingly. Koa also is the word for warrior. Visit their Instagram to find out more about them. And if you aren't already doing so, be sure to follow us on our Facebook and Instagram as well. And until next time, again, Uncle Mahalo Nui. Have a great day. Aloha. Ahui ho.